So a very good evening to everyone present here. So I, Dr. Rajkumar Arya, Associate Professor in Department of Chemical Engineering, NIT Jalandhar, the coordinator of this international short-term course on current and future scope of surface coatings, welcome you to the second session of day two. So the speaker of this session is Dr. Shekhar Agnihotri, who will talk on antimicrobial surface coatings. So let me introduce Dr. Shekhar Agnihotri to everyone present here. We have amidst us Dr. Shekhar Agnihotri, who is an assistant professor at National Institute of Food Technology, Entrepreneurship and Management, Sonipat, Haryana. Dr. Agnihotri completed his PhD in nanotechnology from IIT Bombay. Prior to that, he pursued M.Tech in biochemical engineering from IIT BHU in a joint collaborative research work with IIT Kanpur. Dr. Agnihotri's prime expertise lies in the area of nanobiotechnology and bioprocess engineering, biomass valorizations. He pursues interest in integrating immobilized enzymes and nanosupports for generating value-added products from agro-based novel packaging, intelligent coating, and smart sensing technologies. Dr. Agnihotri has several awards to his credit, being awarded the Excellence Award for Best PhD Thesis from IIT Bombay. He is also the recipient of DST Young Scientist Award, Indo-Japan Young Fellowship Award, Gold SS Award, Royal Society of Chemistry UK, TI Best Performance Award. Dr. Agnihotri is working on several the research grants from India and abroad, worth rupees more than 2 crores, and his research group has bagged many awards and recognition at several national and international platforms. Dr. Agnihotri has published several the research papers and guided more than 10 PhD students. And with this short introductions, now I would like Dr. Shekhar Agnihotri to conduct the session. Over to you, sir.
Okay. First of all, thank you very much, Dr. Arya, for the nice introduction. So first of all, can I share my presentation now? Are my slides visible to you all?
Yes. It's visible and is very beautiful slide of intro in the beginning.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So first of all, I pay my sincere thanks to Dr. Lalit Kumar Awasthi, Honorable Director, NIT Jalandhar, for coordinating and conducting such a very wonderful session of this short-term course, which is based on very much needed topic like surface coating. I also pay my sincere thanks to Dr. Sangeeta Garg, Madam, Head of Department Chemical Engineering at NIT Jalandhar, for having such a very good team. And it's nice to see that you have collated all different experts from different endeavors in a single platform. I think that it's one of those rare events, and big thank to her as well. And lastly, Dr. Rajkumar Arya, the main coordinator, organizer, the main man behind this. So, thank you, sir, for giving me an opportunity to present my work, share my expertise with you all. And definitely, this also opens the window for several types of collaboration and interdisciplinary work. So shall I start?
Yeah. Thank you very much for your nice words. Actually, I will say thanks to you because we were planning to this STC from a long time due to engagement of yours and other experts. Actually, it was possible only this time, actually. So thank you once again to be the part of this acceptance and managing time, actually. So
my pleasure. Okay. So as I see that since this STC session involves a mix of population, right, from expertise of faculty members, there might be some academia, like your industry people, there might be some student as well. So I just start with a very naive and holistic viewpoint of what is nano. So this is very fun-based nanotechnology. People ask that what is a nanotechnology, and somebody says that, okay, you have just trod on it. So it's a invisible technology with an invincible application. Although people say that this nanotechnology is quite new, and that is why it's getting so much of attention, and people are more converging their domain onto this nanotechnology. But what I presume, or as you go along with this nanotechnology, you see that this nanotechnology is not very new. Since the inception of your Earth, since the inception of your evolution, we see that there are nanoscale objects which exist on Earth. Okay, so I just drag you from this nanotechnology, very naive kind of thing, very new thing, onto some of the old phenomenon. And I think we all have been to this. Okay, so I consider myself as that nature is the best nanotechnologist. Am I audible to you all?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So, so the nature for me, it is nature is the best nanotechnologist, and these are two of few phenomenon, two of few structures where we can see. We know that about lotus leaf. Okay, lotus leaf. In its entire time, lotus leaf spends lifespan in mud, or you can say a very high humidity place. Despite this, okay, nothing happens to lotus leaf. It always remain alive because of its super hydrophobicity. And now we have came to know that in the surface of this lotus leaf, we have minuscule crystal, which are essentially of nanotype, which is of, as I've written, it's of 1 nanometer dimension, which makes them super hydrophobic. So even the droplets which falls onto it, or in any of the environment, okay, from where the moisture which is being covered up by or absorbed by this lotus leaf, okay, remains on the surface only. Okay, similarly, there is a very good example of Indian gecko lizard. We can see, okay, on the pads, these are having hair like projection. They are homogeneously being involved. They're homogeneously being distributed, and you can see it totally resembles, okay, the toys of bullets, okay, which we used to play during our childhood days. Okay, so it remains just because of these hair-like projections, again of nanoscale objects of 1 nanometer. It validates the movement of Indian gecko lizard even against the gravity. Okay, so you can see that barely a lizard moves all along the objects, all along area, just because of this hair-like projection of nanoscale. Okay, I'm not going deep into what are the electrostatic phenomenon that is involved, but yes, this is nanotechnology which has been covered in our evolution. Also, we all know that we are made up of DNA, and DNA is nothing but it's a nanoscale object. So we are being taking nanoscale object within us, and hence we should remember this, that it is not, nanotechnology is nothing very new. It has already been in inception. The only thing is now we are harnessing it onto our intended application. So now we should think about that, what happens at nanoscale and what are its phenomenon. So let's say we discuss about two different phenomenon. One is bulk scale. Next is your nanoscale. So there are two things that majorly changes. First of all, it is a ratio of surface area to volume. As soon as you cut down your material from bulk to your nanoscale, there is a drastic change in surface area to volume, and hence the surface energy increases. just because of the surface energy, your materials, they are quite active, they are highly unstable, and hence their energy is the main persona with which nanoscale object work. Okay. Second is quantum confinement effect. As the name indicate, it is more of a physics kind of thing, but just I am just giving you a quick schematic representation. As you can see here in the bottom figure, that there is a bulk object, you can see the energy flow. Okay, this energy diagram is a continuous nature, and as soon as we are cutting down to two dimensional, one dimensional and zero dimensional, like quantum well, quantum wire, quantum dot, we can see below there is a their quantification of energy. That means energy is changing from its continuous level to discrete level. So discreteness of a quanti energy quanta makes nanoscale object some properties which you cannot find in your bulk. Okay, just because I know that there are few students as well, those who have not been to nanotechnology earlier, so just to just show them, I have taken this, like we have a bulk, and then what happens to nanoscale. As you can see in the left portion, we have a gold. So if I ask anyone that what is the color of gold, everybody would say that gold is, yes, gold is golden color, but at nanoscale it can invariably be yellow, deep yellow, wine red, red, purple, blue, whatever color you think, depending upon its size, your nanoscale have different colors. Altogether, silver also, this is one of my research work in which we have shown that nanomaterials right from 5 nanometer to 100 nanometers, how the visible attributes of nanoscale silver changes. So you can see like very, very light yellow, deep red, deep blue, okay, purple color, all those color, they are being shown by your silver nanomaterials. Now, Now we have been well versed with nanotechnology, synthesis of nanomaterials. You can see a deluge of research paper. People are coming, like people are claiming that they have synthesized nanoparticles. They're using it for different applications, whether it's a photocatalytic application, paint industry, coating industry. But there are certain practical limitations. Okay, whenever you use colloidal nanoparticles, okay, there are three major limitations. First is they are prone to get aggregated. What does it mean? You just synthesize your nanomaterials. As I initially said, these nanomaterials are having very high surface energy. So they are nothing but they are bound to be associated again so as to reduce their free energy. So what happens as soon as you start synthesizing, over a due course of time, you will find that your nanomaterials no more remain in that colloidal phase, but they would exist as a aggregate form. And as the aggregation happens, okay, their actual individual efficacy for which they were intended for, it reduces drastically. So that is why it is said that whenever you want to use colloidal nanomaterials, you have to make them freshly prepared and use instantaneously. This is one thing. Now coming towards second thing, yes, since these are colloidal, these are one-time use, you don't have any capacity to reuse them. Why? Because we know that as soon as you reuse them for a particular application, either you throw them, okay, onto your sink, either you throw them onto your canals, okay, eventually, okay, it cannot be reused further. However, we know that these nanomaterials have capacity to reuse multiple times. Okay, but since colloidal nanomaterials, they don't have such offering for us. The last, okay, which is the most detrimental impact of using this colloidal nanomaterials, and nowadays you will see that there are stringent policies frameworks that all countries are making for using nano based material for different applications. So it is leaching to the environment. What is happening whenever we are using nanomaterial, where it is leading to? Nothing. It is leading to our ecosystem, whether it's a soil, whether you dump it within a soil, whether you put it in a canal, it eventually lead to reach to your fresh eco water system, aqueous eco water system, even oceans. So ultimately, as this schematic representation, you can see that all those activity lead to the release of your nanomaterials, nanoscale objects into the environment, which are potentially hazardous. So that's why, as I said, that now there is an utmost concern that we should shift our strategy for using colloidal nanomaterials from its colloidal shape to a shape or a state where they can be easily reused, okay? They cannot be leased into the system, okay? And hence, nowadays, people are working more towards immobilized nanomaterials rather than their colloidal form. So I urge all those students, those who are finding possibilities using nanomaterials in their PhDs or in their research work, I would urge that they should now move a step ahead and they start looking for immobilized nanomaterials. Because making only nanomaterials using for a particular purposes would not solve the societal issues. Even it is causing more harm to society. So that is one request from all students. Sir, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Why I was keep on asking is because in some of the earlier presentation, I kept on giving talk, and somewhere down the line, I realized that okay, there was a mismatch in the internet connectivity. So that's why I just keep on asking this. Okay. So now, since I said that now we have to go from one step ahead. So from colloidal nanoparticles to immobilized nanoparticles, there is an interface. And what is interface? You require one substrate onto which you are going to immobilize your material. So for that, the basic integrity or basic functionality, it's called as surface functionalization. You want your nanomaterials to be modified as such. It can be easily trapped by, or it can be adsorbed by, or it can be covalently bonded to a surface. Okay. So now I would discuss more towards surface immobilization. And I can proudly say that my lab, my students have done immensely well in this field of surface functionalization. And we have used several types of nanomaterials, right from silica, zinc oxide, SU8, which is used in microelectronics, different hydrogels made up of biopolymers like hydroxyethyl cellulose, chitosan, halocyte nanotube. This is our new intervention where we are using it for bioprocessing applications. So I will discuss some of the aspect, and these are four different domains which I would like to include in this talk, that how these coatings can be used for four different application. One is water disinfection, second is biomedical implant, third is nanobiocatalysis, and food packaging applications. So this would be my main area of work and for this current talk. Sir, is it fine?
Yes, sir. It is fine.
Okay.
Go ahead.
So we start with our first domain, that how these nano antimicrobials can be used for water disinfection. So as we know that your water is the elixir of life, it's the most influential media. As per recent data, 45,000 diarrheal cases are there, and it leads to morbidity. So current remedies for these water disinfection, as we often see, okay, whatever water, tap water comes to our household items, what we see that we use chlorine, okay, for disinfectant. The use of chlorine has two major issues. First is it leads to generation of disinfection byproducts, which is called as DBPs. And these DBPs are even more carcinogenic, okay, the byproduct of this. Also, these DBPs are hazardous, and hence there is an utmost requirement that we use some of the material which should not pose any hazardous consequences as they pose. So the very first thing which came into our mind is we always go back and see what happened in the earlier history. So what we find is that since the antiquity, people are using noble metals copper, silver, and gold for antibacterial purposes. So people have started exploring that, can't we use this as a whole, or is there any possibility that these noble metal can be converted from a bulk phase to your nanoscale phase, and hence comes the concept of nano antimicrobial materials. We have seen that among all these gold, copper, silver, the silver has the most promising antibacterial nature because of its oligodynamic action. I mean, you can use it for a diverse range, broad spectrum. You can use it for fungus, for viral, for protozoans, for bacterial, okay, for disease resistant, different pathogenicity, or for all these microbes, silver nanoparticles can be used. And the best part is we have a lower toxicity towards mammals. Okay, we used to eat in our old times, we used to eat in utensils made up of silver. Kings, our emperors used to eat in utensils of gold. That has a more of a health concern rather than wealth. People call it as he has born with a silver spoon. Now we can see that this proverb has much more health significance. So during this, our objective was that we want to develop a method or tool for complete disinfection using some form of silver, which is quick, because we want that this water disinfection should be quick, which can be repeatedly used with good efficacy and with just sufficient release of silver ions. Yes.
Earlier, actually, people used to say that we should eat in the silver pots and all this. So, yes. This is good for brain something?
Yes, sir.
So, is it true?
Yes, sir. Definitely. I mean, even it is said, sometimes people ask me, sir, should we use plastic bottles or not? Or when we should use it? Because we have seen that, okay, some microplastic comes. I said, you just get rid of plastics. Okay. The best thing where the utensils are used are three or four. First is gold. So now we know that, okay, gold utensil cannot be. So there is no practical relevance with that. Even silver. Okay. So if you have silver, your possibility that you can eat in your silver utensil, that's the best thing. The last, which is the best remedy for all these microbes, is you use copper. Okay. Copper utensils. Okay, so the copper utensil is the best way we get rid of all those microbes, and that's the best thing we must follow in day-to-day life.
Okay, thank you.
So this is a very snapshot of as I said that I want to immobilize our nanoparticles onto some substrate. Before that, we should have a requirement of synthesizing in, and synthesizing in a way that all were homogeneous. So this is one of the approach which we started, and we have already patented this technology, where we have a co-reduction approach with dual thermal treatment. And we have synthesized nanoparticles of all shapes. Just a single protocol, you change some of the basic intricacies, which we often hide in because of this patenting thing. And we have synthesized right from 5 nanometer, 7, 10, 15, 20, 30, 50, 63, 85, and 100 nanometer. Same protocol, you need not to change anything except some of the intricacies. Okay. So if somebody wants to discuss this later, I'm pretty open for it. We may discuss this thing, and it's pretty being accepted worldwide. Recently this has been featured in Nature Nanotechnology also, because they used our protocol, and I can proudly say that they have claimed in this paper also that they have it is reproducible enough. And they were able to synthesize all nanoparticles with desired shape. So this is some of the practical relevance of this nanoparticle synthesis. So we have synthesized nanoparticles, and then we used it for first antibacterial activity. That just see that how effective they are. So now people, if I go back, I can see that, okay, we have synthesized 5 to 100 nanometers. And if you go by loss, people say that smaller, the better. So in case of silicon nanoparticles also, we have chosen 3, 4, 5, 7, 10 nanometers particles. And then we have compared their activity. And yes, we have still validated that smallest one, that is 5 nanometer particles, gave us the best result, which shows more than 99% and 99.9%, that is bactericidal and bactericidal impact. Okay, I'll not discuss what are the kinetics. Okay, you can go through this paper of RSC Advances in 2014. You'll be able to get all those things. That this is one of the rare validation of this point, that nanomaterials below 10 nanometers work the most efficiently. Now, as I said, that now we have synthesized nanoparticles, there is a time that we should immobilize them. So this is a paper which we published in Nanoscale in RSC. We used a silanization procedure. This is pretty common in case of microelectronics. So while we were working upon for different application, it's a kind of serendipity which we observed that the glass surface and which we silanized is using AEAP TMS, like amino ethyl, amino propyl, trimethoxysilane. Okay, it results in the immobilization of nanomaterials without using any linker molecule. Okay, that's the best thing. You just put your glass surface with AEAP TMS and then you just pour it onto silver nanoparticle suspension. The entire slide color changes from transparent to yellow, because since these nanoparticles were yellow in color, so a yellow coating were formed using LB film also as well as dip coating. Just to show you the characterization of nanosurface coating. So as you can see in diagram A, B, C, A is a glass surface which is uniformly distributed, or I can say immobilized with your nanoparticles. And here we have seen multi-layer coatings also, not only single layer, but multi-layer. So more the layers, better the efficacy of your nanoparticles coating. Also, we can see this is very high resolution image. We can see that there were cluster also formation, which we called it as nanoparticles islands, as well as bare nanoparticle, which were immobilized onto the surface. These are some of the characterization. I need not to discuss much, but like here we have a XPS spectra, which is very sensitive technique. And we have shown that here silver existed it in many oxidation state, right from silver, because people, as you can go through many research where people say that once you synthesize silver, it exists in metallic form, that is zero valency state, but that is not the case. You can see here we have shown that silver exists in metallic form, silver oxide, silver Ag2, Ag2O, AgO, Ag2O, different aspects. Okay, so and this silver oxide film is even important for silver to mediate its antibacterial action. So that is what we claim. Now coming towards disinfection potential. So we made a continuous reactor. Again, I did not include that part. Okay, we made some reactor onto which we introduced our contaminants. So we have used E. coli, two different strain, then Bacillus subtilis. So E. coli is gram negative, Bacillus is gram positive, and we took two different initial bacterial concentration, like 10 to the power 3 colony forming units per ml and 10 to the power 5 colony forming units per ml. The purpose of using this this values is because in real and practical relevance, we find that the concentration of your contaminants which occur in your drinking water, they lie within that. So just we want to measure that if that would be the case, whether our immobilized glass with nanoparticles is is bactericidal or not. Okay, so here we can see that what we observed, that complete disinfection we could be able to achieve in 2 hours. When I say complete disinfection, that means when we started with 10 to the power 3 CFU per ml or 10 to the power 5 CFU per ml, we get zero count. That means we did not get even a single colony of these microbes. So this is pretty different from how people claim, because in most of the cases you would find that people say that, okay, we had 100% bacteria and it reduced to 10%. Okay, so 90% have been reduced. It makes no sense, because even if you have a 10%, they start growing themselves, because these are bacteria, they start multiplying them and again reach to its original colonies. So we just want to make sure that our silver based immobilized matrix is going to completely eradicate the presence of your microbes onto your drinking water. So this is how we said. And this worked efficiently for all the strains. It is not like that only E. coli was very sensitive, only Bacillus was very sensitive. Okay, there, yes, there is a subtle difference in their sensitivity, but yes, we were able to achieve complete eradication in all the microbes which we used for. And as I mentioned, that there is no use of nanomaterials if you cannot reuse them. So we also predict the reusability. So what we see as in figure A, there is subsequent use. So what we see, that there is a slight reduction in the kinetics. That means, yes, the efficacy of your nanoparticles lead in glass was reducing, but it is very important to see that the five, can somebody see this where I'm moving my cursor? This, can somebody tell me?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So the extent of disinfection. Yes.
Yeah. You are at baton 50, right?
Yeah. So the extent of disinfection remained same. That means even we were using it over a required period of time, after every reuse, even after 11th time, we could be able to get zero colony at 50 minutes. That means you have a reactor, you keep on using it, water, over a period of time, for 11th time, your period of disinfection remained same. Although there was a difference in the concentration of silver, which is leased out of the system. Okay. So what we observed is that our silver laden glass has the same potential to disinfect water after multiple reuse, which manifested.
Wait. Just let me mute actually.
हाँ अभी अडानी अडानी ले रहे जल जाएगा.
हाँ हाँ वही मैं कहूँ क्या ना बेस्ट पास लू चले.
या कंटिन्यू.
ओके. So we have shown that we are silver immobilized glass material had a very good immobilization property, and it can be reused for 11 times without any significant change in its disinfection ability. So we started correlating. So this is one of the results which we observed. So we started elucidating the mechanism of this. What we observed is that also there was a subtle change in the silver release profile, but the extent of disinfection, that is the time to achieve disinfection, remained same. How it happened? Okay, so we came to know that silver ion release could not be the sole mechanism which is governing the antimicrobial impact of this immobilized nanoparticles. Rather, we gave a new hypothesis which is called as contact killing of immobilized nanoparticles, and this is one of the
yes, can please, I ask sir. Something so generally in this water purifier, people these days are putting copper cylinder,
yes.
right? Just to So in place of copper cylinder, if we will put the silver, will it be much more the means better than that?
Yes, sir. Even you would find that many this water purification technology, they use nano silver based. You can just Google it. You would find even Tata purifiers, Tata Swachh, and even your this one. What's the brand name? I'm not remembering. What's the name? That all they are using nano silver.
Live pure.
Okay. Yeah. AquaGuard. Mm-hmm. Okay. So they are using this nano silver based technology. However, the issue with them is what they're using it. They are making some silver candles. The ceramic candles onto which they are entrapping this silver into it. So what is happening during the due course of its use? All the silver gets released out. And hence, it is no more available for over a next period of time. So you need to replenish them. Either you take a new candle, your silver get released and eventually leads to your ecosystem. For us, what we want that we can just replace your candle and we can make some of the silver your silver glass based cylinders. Where silver retains there, it does not leach out. So what is happening? Your silver, see, what silver does, like silver, first of all, you know that silver is a, like silver oxide, it's a positive. As I said that silver at metallic form is not bactericidal, it required oxidation. So as it forms silver oxide, so silver becomes silver ions, Ag2+ or Ag+. So these Ag plus and your microbes are essentially negatively charged because we know that they contains your peptidoglycan and all phospholipids. So they are negatively charged. So these silver, they sense a kind of attraction mechanism. They first of all attracts your bacteria. As soon as bacteria comes, it makes a contact with them. And as soon as it makes contact, it started releasing its one of component, which is just sufficient for its killing. So eventually it attracts and kills.
Okay.
So this, let me tell you, when we elucidated this mechanism before it, people used to say that no, silver cannot be bactericidal until unless silver gets leached out. And we were one of the few who have started telling, no, your silver can also work as a contact killing. So this is that forms the basis of our research group, that we don't go for release of silver, but we go for contact based killing.
Just one question.
Yes.
So in let's say a common man who doesn't know anything, people used to put a copper container or ball in the filter.
Yeah.
So if we will put a silver glass there,
yes,
would it give us some means that effect or some benefit at least?
Definitely. We have already filed a patent. And we are looking for some of the industrial collaboration. We have one industry which is, it's a 2-month news that, okay, we are going to put it on a scale side. Like we are scaling it up and we are making some of the candle filters. That is why I was telling that we are making candle filters in which we have this silver nanoparticles coated onto it. And it is giving us very good results.
Okay, good. Best of luck with that. Continue.
Thank you. So now people started telling that, okay, this is what the comments we received throughout the globe when we first present this paper. And people said that, so why only immobilized nanoparticles or colloidal nanoparticles? Why can't you use different forms of silver also that exist? And see whether there is a comparison in them and what is giving you best result. So we used silver chloride plate, pure silver plate also, the same silver plate we used, and along with immobilized nanoparticles. And what we find that was very exciting, that your silver nanoparticles glass substrate gave us the best result, fastest time, complete disinfection happened. Okay. As compared to other form like AgCl, like silver chloride and silver plate, this was extended to 75 minutes. So your disinfection was delayed. Although also the complete disinfection was achieved, but it delayed from 50 minutes to 75 minutes. Eventually, more profound effect we observed in case of release of silver. And what we observed is our silver nanoparticles were releasing silver only 25 ppb. And other forms of silver, they are releasing 100 ppb. Now, as a data, people say, okay, it's a 4-time release. But if you go with the WHO guidelines, what we find that the maximum limit of silver in your water is 100 ppb. That means any material which claims that, okay, disinfect water, but if it is releasing silver more than 100 ppb, it is unsafe to use. And WHO rejects it. And we were pretty sure in that because we were 1/4 of that limit, pretty lower than that. So we were only 25 ppb and still giving you the best, or I would say better results than other sources of silver. And hence we said that our nanoparticles were more profoundly killing or inhibiting bacterial growth. Just to see further.
So yes, one sir. More yeah, question please. Here. Suppose you said the 100 ppb, less than that is safe.
Yes.
More than that is not safe, correct?
Yes.
So suppose we have put just a glass in a filter, actually container where store the filtered water.
Yeah.
So will that concentration will go beyond 100 ppb?
Yes.
Will it go or will it not go actually? Because we are not doing anything to the release. It is automatic getting the release into the water.
Yes.
From that.
Yeah. So for this, my answer would be.
So would it be possibility that it may go beyond that or it may not go?
Sir, I would answer this with saying that since we did not have any policy framework in India, where
any practical.
So we did not have any policy frameworks where we could be able to quantify that what is the amount this candle filter with nano silver, they are leaching it out. Just to quote you one example, like if you compare with the same, earlier in 2006, Samsung launched a washing machine having nano silver. And they say that since this washing machine itself has a container where silver is being used, and since while washing your clothes, okay, your microbes which are contained into it, they would also get killed. But that Samsung company did not utter anything about silver release. And eventually, in South Korea, people claim the toxicological consequences of this using this washing machine, and there was a product recall. They have to take back this. So that's the strategies that is being followed throughout the globe, except in India. India, we don't have. So I cannot claim onto it, but yes, as far as my practical relevance and my expertise, they don't have any control on the amount of silver which is released. But let me tell you also, 100 ppb, since it's a codex which is being regulated by WHO, but even if you, because this 100 ppb is nothing, even if you are taking it, it is safe. Don't consider it as a highly hazardous or chemically hazardous. Silver of 100 ppb, if you are using it, it's okay.
ओके ओके ओके
So then we discussed several other anim. So we were keep on validating that whatever we claim, this is true. There is a nanoparticles which are being trapped by your microbes. So as you can see here, this is scanning electron microscope. Transmission electron microscope, and you can see internalization. Internalization means your bacteria. Get attracted by this immobilized silver nanoparticles, and then eventually silver get engulfed inside your bacteria, and those bacterias were killed by them. So this is one. I mean, many strategies we have seen on the surface also. These are bacterial images which they are unanimously being trapped by your microbes. So. With this, we already claim that okay, now this nanoparticles immobilized onto glass material can be used for water disinfection purposes. And in the next phase, in the next step, we tried to use it under environmentally relevant conditions. Like what is, because whatever experiment which I've just shown, these were done in deionized water. I mean, we took DI water because we did not want to have any issues with the presence of any other ions. So we use deionized water, and in which we have externally contaminated with our microbes. Now we move toward another, where we use what is the impact of different water quality and how it impacted the antimicrobial behavior of our silver laden glass. So here we have published in Chemical Engineering Journal, where we used different parameters, alkalinity. So what is the impact of alkalinity? What is the impact of hardness? What is the impact of presence of organic matter like humic acid? And we took all these different ranges. And let me tell you, this range is, again, it has a practical relevance. All our lakes, freshwater lakes, throughout Indian subcontinent, all the parameters lie within this range. Okay, so all the alkalinity, hardness, and organic matter, the ranges are the extremities, and all this fall. So if we said if our microorganism present on these parameters, if they are being killed by our silver-based disinfection product, definitely it is going to use it invariably at all regions throughout the globe as well. So this is what we shown. Again, there is a validation that for different alkalinity, the time to achieve complete disinfection remained 100 minutes. Okay, and 100 minutes. So you can easily see from 70 minutes, it delayed to 100 minutes. Definitely, there is a presence of alkalinity. So alkaline conditions delayed our disinfection profile. But what we observed, there is a complete disinfection occurs, and again at very high alkalinity condition, it is still complete disinfection was achievable. Okay, so we have shown that there is a contact killing mechanism which is again prevailing in case of our immobilized system. Effect of hardness also, again we have shown here that for different hardness, although our disinfection profile was delayed, as you can see, from 100 minutes it delayed to 120, then 135, then 150, if you keep on increasing the hardness. And it is very true also that if you keep on increasing hardness, what happens, your hardness, it occurs because of the calcium and magnesium divalent cations. So what they do, these divalent cations, they itself form a bond between silver. Okay, so silver get entrapped in that, and it no more remain accessible for microbes to kill. Okay, so here we also shown that this nanoparticles were also getting inhibited by hardness, but still at 150 milligram per liter of your hardness, 120 150 ppm, we were able to achieve complete disinfection. Lumicresol also, again, there is a delayed in profile, but complete disinfection was achieved up to your 4 ppm of humic acid, and 4 ppm is at the extreme side of the presence of organic matter present in freshwater, lakes, ponds, rivers. These are different modeling which we did for assessing the kinetics or disinfection. So home model, multiple target, select guard. I'll not discuss much about, but the only thing is home model gives us the best fit. And then we estimated the lumped parameter. And from this, we could be able to envisage that while you are scaling up your protocol, your strategy, what are the parameters you need to control on in order to achieve complete disinfection over repeated use. Because ultimately, people are not going to use it over a single time or one time. People want to use it multiple times. So we just want to model it that up to how much time it can be used it without any processing, and then what processing is needed. Okay. So that we have already modeled it. So this was all about our immobilized silver onto glass plate. And if you permit, I may extend it to our next work. Dr. Arya, can I proceed? Hello, Dr. Arya? Hello.
Hello. Yeah, I lost the connection. That's okay.
Okay. So.
Yeah.
Was so I audible to everyone?
Yes. You are the audible actually.
Achha. Okay.
I lost connection actually.
Oh, no problem. No problem. So I would move towards next study where, so we have already shown that this immobilized silver onto glass have been modeled, and we have already scaled up this technology. And then this was our new intervention where this nanoparticles were immobilized on zinc oxide. So earlier it was silica, and now we took substrate as a zinc oxide. But again, we put substrate as a glass. So now, yes. Yeah, any questions? Shall I proceed?
I think there is no question. You can continue, I think.
Okay. So this is a paper we published in Nanoscale, and this was a back-to-back publication in the same journal where once we have already validated, we have given some extension of this work. So now glass substrate, we included one more coating material of zinc oxide nanoparticles and nanorods, and then onto nanorods we somewhat incorporated our silver nanoparticles. So here we use a very safe linker, which is arginine. Arginine, we all know that arginine is one of the amino acids, and arginine, people before that, people did have not used this arginine for any cross linking. And we have shown that arginine as a bidentate cross linker, it can easily bind silver onto zinc oxide, making them even more efficacious for disinfection purpose. So it gives us synergistic action. Zinc oxide, as we know, it's a photocatalytic material, and it does have antibacterial nature. So once zinc oxide was associated with silver, its efficacy was increased manifold. So here we can see that, okay, we have a synthesis of zinc oxide and a bunch flower of very beautiful flower of zinc oxide, onto which we have a beaded kind of appearance of this silver nanoparticles. and we have given the elemental mapping also. As you can see that we had zinc, oxygen, silver, very dotted green color silver, and then this silicon. Okay, that is of because of the glass substrate. So it has validated. And here this stamp figure, you can see this is a very high resolution figure of at the bottom figure. You can see there is a interface between silver as well as zinc oxide. As you can see, this is a clear interface. And this we have further zoom, you can see this is a interface. And this interface has easily validated that this silver was bonded well to zinc oxide using our arginine as a cross linker. Okay. So we have shown, this is a representation. We had a glass slide where zinc oxide white color strip, and then it changed to somewhat yellow color because of this silver. And you can see these are microbes, bacterial colonies. Here, zinc oxide alone has a very feeble antibacterial impact. And as you can see, as the silver was introduced, there was a zone of inhibition. This is called as zone of inhibition. All the space near to silver zinc oxide, this nanorods, your microbes were unable to grow. So it is called as zone of inhibition. It's a one of the parameter with which you can say that your silver is, or your material is bactericidal. Okay. We have again done the same experiment for different use, and we have shown that yes, it can be used 11 times. With again, this silver concentration was close to 100, and it reduced to 27. So it gave us again confidence that whatever surface functionalization protocol which we are following, we are going in a right direction, and hence we initiated our studies further. These are very beautiful pictures. These are rare events. We were also very astonished while we received this this stem image. You can see that this is a bacterial image. I am moving my cursor, and these are different events. You can see these are some of the black spots. These are nothing but silver, and we have seen some phenomenon. Can you see, this is a bacterial membrane, and this silver is going to come inside. That means bacteria is engulfing this silver nanoparticles. So it is called as silver nanoparticles internalization. They are getting internalized inside your bacteria. Okay. Now it has been engulfed. Now it has reached inside. It is recently been in the near to the plasma membrane. So we have shown that whatever we were claiming, that there is a more likely that nanoparticles are getting internalized inside cell, that was true. Also, we have seen there is a significant disruption of your bacterial cells as well. Bacteria cells, porosity, their membrane becomes more permeable, and hence they lost its efficacy. So this is how we describe our material to be highly bactericidal. Now, in order to this, we also wanted to show that whether this is it is having any impact on our normal cells or not. So here this is a diagram where we have shown that our cell viability remains 100% for all the treatment, except in 48 hours, there is a slightly chances only 10% of cells get killed, but 90% of our cells remain viable even when it is exposed to silver zinc oxide hybrid nanorods. So here we have shown that your nano particles laden zinc oxide is highly bactericidal, yet it does not pose any cytotoxic responses towards mammalian cells. Okay, so that was the best part of this entire work. Now, just considering the same glass based immobilization of silver, we thought that now what are the possibilities we can improve the efficacy. So either we increase the density or we increase the surface area, because if we increase the surface area, definitely more silver will get absorbed or immobilized, and hence efficacy would be higher. So we shifted from our two dimensional to fibers. We took different types of glass fibers, and it was modified by different strategies, and then we compared its activity. So rather than a place, rather than taking a very flat glass plate, we now modified or we replaced it by using glass fibers, and those glass fibers are used in a continuous reactor for water disinfection purpose. So it was a glass fiber. We can see that nanoparticles are immobilized, and here we have observed that our AGNP, that is silver glass fibers, gives us better results. The only possible, the only thing is that there is a more chance of release of silver. As you can see here, the silver release was 80 to 90, although it is below threshold limit, but we went up to that high limit. So we restrained ourselves and we modified our glass fibers so as to mitigate the possible leaching of our silver nanoparticles. So if I so concluding all those three studies altogether, what are the conclusions or take home messages? That immobilization of silver nanoparticles on a surface functionalized solid surface appear to be effective. It has a multiple time reusability, it is economical, it minimizes the ecotoxicological implication, and the main mechanism with which it was giving a better response, it is contact healing rather than silver release. Okay. Now coming towards next impact, that rather we left out our glass-based material and it was replaced by another material which is called as hydrogel. Okay. So we synthesize chitosan polyvinyl alcohol hydrogel. Hydrogel is a very foamy kind of material which absorbs water without getting dissolved in it. Okay. And recently we published paper in Environmental Science Nano. It's very high impact publication. And here we have shown that those nanoparticles, they are absorbed inside the polymeric matrices of these hydrogels. And you can see here the mechanical strength. We have loaded it 50 gram, even 2 kg. We have not shown it here. Even 2 kg of weight, it can easily withstand without getting any deformation. We have validated it using all those mechanical attributes like stress strain parameter, Young modulus of rigidity, percentage, elongation. And it was observed that while this silver was immobilized onto these hydrogel, okay, it further improves the mechanical property by dislocating the stress which is located at a particular location of your hydrogel. It percolates at all the your polymeric networks, and hence the impact reduces. We have also seen the swelling ratio of this, and it swells better. However, we have seen as you immobilize your nanoparticles, it swells lesser. Okay? So swelling was lesser in case of your immobilized nanomaterials. These are scanning electron microscopy, and you can see here, this is very high magnification, and you can see your all the dots are nanoparticles. This is and the base, and the base is your polymer of chitosan PVA hydrogel. Again, showing zone of inhibition. We have used all strains which is used for biomedical as well as your water disinfection. So E. coli, Enterobacter aerogens, these are the representatives for water disinfection. Vice Staph aureus, okay, this is pathogenic microorganisms. S. epidermidis, which is used in biomedical implants. We have shown that this hydrogel can kill all of those. Okay, I'm not going to have a deep details about what is a disinfection kinetics, but it killed all the microbes, whether it's a biomedical, whether it's environmental relevant microorganisms, all they have been killed. We have also shown that even if you keep on increasing the CFU count from 10 to the power 4 to 10 power 5 to 10 power 6, the killing was more than 80%. Again, the reusability, it was used for 10 times. The silver release was 70 ppb. So as in the previous lectures, in the previous, we have shown that this, we are pretty much sure about ppb. It should not go beyond 100 ppb. Otherwise, it will be failed. And then last one is biofilm inhibition, where we have shown that it also inhibits the biofilm formation of several biomedical implants, which is used like in case of which are being attacked by Staph aureus or your S. Staph epidermidis. Then we used environmentally relevant samples. So different canal water, tap water, groundwater was taken. And this hydrogel was able to disinfect all environmentally relevant samples within a time frame of 180 minutes. So by 3 hours, your complete bio your water will be disinfected. So our aim was nowadays, because we are transforming this technology in rural areas. So we are making one portable water filters, which is potable as well as portable, which is used, which will be used in rural areas where we have a hydrogel kind of film or coating onto these candles, and it can be used without the use of any electricity. You just pass it through with the help of with the gravity driven flow. It can easily kill all microorganisms in 3 hours. So this story which I told you, this was all about water disinfection and how this coating can be used. Quickly move towards next is how this biomedical coatings, this coating can be used. So we know about biomaterial associated infections. Those who have not been to this, we know that whatever sutures, catheters, implants, which is done during operations, okay, they are the niche of these pathogens. So eventually what happens if these implants are implanted in your body, eventually they are being attacked by these microorganisms, and eventually they form biofilm, and the last solution is there is a rejection and you have to keep that implant material out. So it created a great sense of morbidity in especially in US, and also there was a huge economic loss. So that loss, okay, the potential solution could be a nano antimicrobial coating. Okay, so we have these three different types of coating where either your antibacterial agent can be leased out. Like for example, we know that all these implants, they are coated with antibiotics. Okay, second thing is contact killing, as we mentioned. And we have already published several book chapters onto it, several reports where we shown that once it is contact killing, it is also one of the method. And third is anti-adhesiveness. That means you make your coating anti-adhesiveness, hydrophobic, okay, so that it won't let your microorganisms to make a biofilm onto those surface. So we have done several coating characterization like FTIR, XRD, UV protector, protection factors. These are implants. You can see these are stainless steel implants, and we have shown that this these are the very exhaustive study. We have not published it yet. So we have shown this, that all these coatings, once they are coated with this silver, graphene oxide nanoparticles, they pretty mitigate the impact of your biomedical pathogens like Staph epidermidis and Staph aureus. We've also shown the antimicrobial activity by your fluorescence assay, and these are some of the results where we have shown that a coating of chitosan polyvinyl alcohol with graphene oxide of 0.05%, it gave us the best result in terms of making its coating as well as for mechanical aspect. Okay, so this is the suture. This is a screw which is used for microbial coating, and we have used it without coating as well as coating, and we have shown here in the background that we have a clear zone of inhibition around this coating. This is coated with chitosan, silver, graphene oxide. Graphene oxide is one of the other nanomaterial which is recently being gained experience. So this was about your biomedical coating. The next coating is using antimicrobial coaters for extending the fresh fruit shelf life. And this is also unpublished. We have used a reusable wrapper where it is being coated onto the fruits such as your grapes. And we shown that this lead to increase in the shelf life under ambient condition. Okay, nowadays the major limitations with all these perishable commodities are that you require some cold storage treatment or modified or controlled atmosphere treatment, but here we have shown that it lead to a better shelf life for 7 days. Okay, this is a single layer packaging conditions where we can see that our nano composite it remains viable even after 7 days. Okay, we are still taking hope that this shelf life can be extended further if we improve some of new deliberations into it. So we have shown that this microbial wrappers in which we have a contact based killing, it has a good biodegradability, it has a good biocompatibility, and it has a controlled release of these antimicrobial substance which does not create any kind of hazardous, or you can easily use them. So they are also fall within a category of edible films for perishable commodities. The last one, okay, this is the last part of this lecture where I am showing, although it is not relevant directly with coating, but here we have shown that how this nano coating can be used even for bioprocessing. And we started a new domain which is called as nano bioprocessing. So we made a high fructose corn syrup which is used in food and beverages as a sweetener, and we hypothesized that we convert non-edible lignocellulosic biomass, like which is agro waste, which converts into high fructose corn syrup via nano biocatalysis. So these are some of the pre-treatment. We isolated cellulose and then we converted into a form which is called as using cellulase, which is immobilized on halocytes nanotubes. Okay, and we recently published in ACS Sustainable Chemistry and Engineering, and we were able to convert them into a form which is used for saccharification. What is saccharification? We are converting our material, that is cellulose, into glucose, and then glucose was converted into fructose with the use of another immobilized enzyme which is called as fructose glucose isomerase. So glucose isomerase converts glucose into fructose. So from non-edible source, which is sugarcane bagasse, which has no relevance, it is a agro waste, we can convert even into edible form, which is. So this was our strategy. So it is we need to have very high saccharification rate, which is more than 54%. It has a very high tolerant ability of ionic liquids. We have used several ionic liquids, and our enzyme worked very well, very efficiently, and we have shown that it achieved 50.2% saccharification, and we were able to convert 0.56 gram of glucose per gram of cellulose. It's very high amount. Okay, out of 1 gram, 0.56 gram was converted from your agro waste within 48 hours of continuous operation. So we have used different aspect, and this is a proof of concept. This proof of concept have recently been approved by Department of Biotechnology, BIREC. And we have recently received one of the grant from DBT BIREC as well. So where we have proved this concept, and now we are making it on a large scale as a continuous fixed bed, not a continuous fixed bed reactor. So this study is is still ongoing, and we are hoping that we give a possible solution. As we know that in Haryana and Punjab, we are pretty much aware about stubble burning. So this could be one of the most feasible solution where stubble can be converted into cellulose and then converted into glucose or other fructose or other biochemical product. So this was all about my research area in which I'm using coating-based material for disinfection purposes, for biomedical implants, for food packaging as edible coating, and also for conversion of agro waste into important biochemical products. Last, I would like to acknowledge all those funding agencies. I've been generously funded by Department of Science Technology as an extramural grant, BIREC, as I said. I've also been to Indo-Japan and Indo-Israel grant recently. This is an international grant, and in my organization also, I've received internal funding. I would like to thank collaborators like Professor Ravi Shukla from RMIT Australia, Professor Kelly from North Carolina State University, U.S., Professor Yoshihiro Ito, he's a Nobel laureate, he works in RIKEN. Dr. Eyal Friedman in Israel, Professor Philomena in Italy, and nevertheless, our beloved Dr. Rajkumar Arya at NIT Jalandhar. We have already published two papers, and many are still pending. And finally, I would thank my PhD students, Devendra Sillu, Navneet, Anjali, and my MTech student Shubharna. They tirelessly worked in my research group. Whatever may be the conditions, I used to scold them at often time, but they keep on working, and it is because of them that we were able to publish in very high impact publications. Thank you very much. I rest all of you with a very good fun facts related with nanotechnology. And I am open with all the questions if required.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Shekhar, to introduce the nanotechnology and clubbing it with biology, microbiology, and then coating, and with various applications. And I am really excited to see your nano candles and for this bacterial application part. So now participants can ask the question. They can turn on their videos and have the interaction, and then they can actually talk and ask their questions or maybe some doubts or something.
Yeah, please.
So we can talk to each other and that. So anyone wants to ask from participant side? At least they can turn on their video. At least we will say the who yes. were there. Actually, we can interact each other.
Yeah.
So
I'm sure they were listening, right?
Listening, yeah. Only these days, people want to listen only. Actually, no, no. I'm just saying on the lighter side only. So listening is because sometimes it looks very interesting, and people are learning, and everybody is not working in that particular field.
Yes, yes.
So people get the idea actually what can be done and what others are doing actually.
Yeah.
And so as I was asking for that the silver thing actually, so yeah. If let's say we have a normal water filter and in the bottom of that we have a storage tank. So suppose we put a silver glass there or maybe a copper glass also there. So as you say that, I don't hope the concentration will go to a harmful extent or something, because natural the release will not be that much fast, I hope so.
Right. Exactly. You made it a point. I mean, because it is a bulk silver, na? So bulk not that kind of reactivity. So as compared to nanoscale, like if you take 1 gram of bulk silver and 1 gram of nanomaterials, I think it is 10 to the power 11 times more efficacious. So again, the hazardousness and toxicity would also be 10 to the power 11 times more. So if you keep, I mean, you just put 1, 2, 3 coins of silver onto your tank, storage tank, it won't harm nothing.
And it would be beneficial also from the So any question from participant side, they can ask actually. And so let's ask them name wise actually, otherwise they won't ask. Manju, do you have that?
Sir, any myself, myself Avinash, I am researching
Can you type your question, because the voice is breaking actually.
Yes.
So I want to ask one more. You receive surface energy.
Yes.
Surface energy something.
Yeah, please. What I assume that I think he wants to know about what is surface energy. Okay. I would tell that, see, this when you discuss about your nanomaterials, the very first thing we must come into, see, that these are some of the phenomenon which we observe, that what is the location of your atoms at bulk scale and location of atoms at your nanoscale. So what we find that
can I read his question? So he says, how silane group efficient for reducing surface energy?
Silane group efficient for reducing surface energy. A silane group, actually, primarily we are using as a cross linker, because definitely we have one thing is we have a nanomaterials, nanoparticles, and one is glass. In order to have a kind of close linking immobilization, you require a cross linker. So this, what we did, first of all, we had a glass. So we generated some of the group with which this silane can be easily immobilized. And then we had an aminosilane, which aminosilane can easily bind our silver. So basically this silver, your silane worked as a cross linker, nothing more than that. Okay. As your grouping aggregation happens, your surface energy decreases. That's
the
point.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Debyani, do you have any questions?
I would be happy if like any of the faculty members would ask, because that also opens the possibility of any collaboration, because we want that we can collaborate as many as you. But I'm, if anybody wants to have a collaboration, I think Dr. Rajkumar Arya is already there. I mean, he is a point of contact for any kind of collaboration.
The one question, can you read that?
I'll read my. So best fabrication method for super hydrophobic coating, somewhere written sol gel, somewhere electroless painting. Okay. Avinash, super hydrophobic coatings can be made by n number of ways. It depends upon mode that people are preferring for. But yes, people have shown electroless painting also. Electrolytic plate painting, your super hydrophobic coating was also made by using Langmuir-Blodgett film as well. So there are n number of ways. Okay, this is a sort of compression can be done, but nobody can claim that okay, this method is the best method or ideal method for making super hydrophobic surface. Still, there is many ways we have to go or we have to achieve. Is it clear to you, Avinash? Thank you. Thank you.
Anyone else wants to ask something?
Yes, sir. I have a question. Good evening, sir. Myself,
yeah,
Anshul.
Good evening,
I'm
Anshul.
From, yes, yeah. Sir. I'm from MTech first year. Sir, as okay. You said that
she's our, we are using... She's our MTech. Yeah, yeah. Just ask.
Okay. Well, that's good.
Then I will.
Yes, sir.
She's
sir,
our
you...
first year most means you can say energetic.
Dynamic student, and...
yeah, dynamic, energetic, very intelligent,
that's good.
And hardworking.
See, whenever I see some students like this, okay, then we also get excited that yes, there is much more hope to work with these new brigade which is coming.
Yeah, yeah. So she is very active, talented, and very punctual also. So now you ask your question, Anshul.
Thank you. Sir.
Yes, Anshul.
Yes, sir. So as I was saying, you said that you were using coatings for increasing the shelf life of edible substances, edible coatings. Sir, so basically what they are doing is they are affecting the natural ripening process of that food item, like you used grapes. So that is affecting the natural ripening process of that food item. Sir, does it also have some harmful effect like for consuming? Would it be harmful in some way?
Very, very, very good question. Okay, it's very relevant also. Okay, you hit it on a very right side. First of all, we must see whenever we have an edible coating, so we have to see that at which stages you are going to coat them. First, whether it's a pre-harvest stage, just before harvest stage, just before the maturity you are coating it, or you are coating it at the time of its storage. So whenever you have a storage time, for example, if I took grapes and I made a coating out of it, what we are aiming at, that now it should not be over-ripened. So this is very first thing. Second thing is that while it should not be over-ripened, is there any possibility that if you keep it under ambient conditions, the microbes would come and they started deteriorating its quality. So we have to have a good balance between both of them, that it should not limit its over-ripening. It should also mitigate the occurrence of any occurrence of any microorganisms which would create a food spoilage. So this requires a piece of research intervention where we are planning to tune the functionality of our edible coating in a way that its water vapor transmission ability, its water absorption capacity, its over ripening ability, and in concurrent to your food spoilage can be taken care of.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Another question from Avinash. Can
Okay, Avinash. Why we move from hydrophobic to super hydrophobic? Explain how researchers form models to know contact angle. Any new field left in super hydrophobic coatings for research which helps our society? Avinash, super hydrophobicity is something which is earlier it used to be a hypothesis. Now people are getting some of the realm of this super hydrophobicity. To give you just one example, you just type on Google, there are some coating on to shoes for civil workers, those who work in mud and those who work in cement factories. So there are coatings where no water can be absorbed. We have self-cleaning windows in Japan. You visit Japan, you would find that almost 95% of their windows, they are self-cleaned. They have super hydrophobic coating materials like titania, that is TiO2. So in the presence of, although dust comes, like dust is nothing but it's an organic impurities. So it falls onto it, and as soon as light falls on the next day, it cleaves their bond and again it is ripped off. So super hydrophobicity has an immense performance. Regarding your how researchers form models. So contact angle, we know that any hydrophobic surface go beyond 90 degree, they are said to be your hydrophobic. But super hydrophobicity, we go beyond 105 and 110. So now, as I said in the initial lecture, I told you that nature is the best nanotechnologist. Do you know that what is the contact angle of lotus leaf? It is close to 121, and we have not yet achieved it. So that's why the concept, a new area which came into picture, as you asked that what is the area which is left, please note it down. It is called as biomimetics. So people are now started working on biomimics, how to mimic the natural phenomenon for our intended application. So yes, super hydrophobicity has a very, very diverse application. It has good scope. People are working, especially in like Japan, Germany, and Norway. So you can refer some of the research groups there. If you want, I can also give you some of the details. You just contact Dr. Rajkumar Arya, and I can provide you all those information. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Any other question from any other participant? So, if there are no questions, so I would thank once again Dr. Shekhar Agnihotri to accept our invitation to be part of this short-term course. Obviously, you were busy the whole day, whole week, when your meetings and your conference activities, convocation means activities, and still you have managed time for this program, actually.
It's my pleasure only. I mean, whenever I get any response from Dr. Rajkumar Arya, I mean, I'm always there. As a collaborator, as a friend, as a senior, I mean, you have been amazing for these years, and hopefully our collaboration and friendship would continue. The opportunity which you gave me, it's a good that at least I would be able to share my expertise and interact with like Anchal, Avinash. Okay, they asked all those questions, and that's the thing, I mean, which perpetuates us ourselves to work even better.
So with this, the thank you very much once again, and so we will end this session here. So tomorrow our first session would start at 11 o'clock, so I would request all participants to join at 10:50. It would be first talk on UV coating growth driver for the surface coating industries by Mr. Praveer Das. He is paint consultant and former factory head, Berzer Paint India, Russia operations. And the second talk would be at 2 o'clock by Dr. Karnal Singh, faculty advisor, American University of Sharjah, UAE, on film formation in water-based dispersions, actually. So these would be two talk on the tomorrow. So today we will end here. So thank you once again for all participants to be actively participating in all these sessions, interacting, and listening carefully. And we will meet tomorrow at 10:50. So with this, thank you very much. Have a nice evening.
Yeah, thank you. Have a nice day.
Thank you, Shekhar, once again.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Bye. So we will close the meeting here now.